We are going to discuss about joints today, the different types and some important topics on the joints. First of all, what is a joint? In anatomy, a joint is a junction between two or more bones. So a joint in anatomy is a junction. Junction between what? Junction between two or more bones. Junction between two or more bones. There are few synonyms of the joint that are very frequently used in medical literature, and it is important for a medical student to know the various synonyms which are commonly used. For example, the term articulation or arthrosis means a joint in Latin. So a synonym of joint is articulation or arthrosis. The term arthrology is the study of joint. Study of joint is known as arthrology. Inflammation of a joint is known as arthritis. Inflammation of a joint is known as arthritis. Okay. Basically, a joint is a device in a body which is meant to permit movements. But there are some joints which are immobile and partly mobile. Okay. So, in short, joints are defined as junction between two or more bones. There are numerous joints in human body, and next we will discuss the classification of joints, both structurally and functionally. Next is the classification of joint. The joints can be classified according to their structure or according to their function. We will discuss the functional classification first, followed by the structural classification. So first we go on to the functional classification. Functional classification. Functional classification is based on the degree of mobility of the joint, and they are of three types. Number one is the immobile joints, which show no mobility or no movement. So first is immobile joints, immobile or immovable joints, showing no movement. They are also known as synarthrosis. Synarthrosis. Next is the slightly mobile or slightly movable joint, which are also known as amphiarthrosis. Slightly movable or mobile joints, also known as amphiarthrosis. And the third variety is the freely mobile or movable joints, which are known as the diarthrosis. Freely movable or mobile joints known as diarthrosis. Okay. So there are three fundamental functional classification of joints: immobile, slightly mobile, and freely mobile joints. So that's pretty easy. Now we will go on to the structural classification of the joints. So the structural classification. The structural classification is based upon the type of connecting tissue and the presence or absence of a joint cavity. And these joints are classified into three types: fibrous, cartilaginous, and synovial. Three types: fibrous, cartilaginous, and synovial. So these are the three structural classification of the joints. Okay. Fibrous joints are those where the bones forming the joint are united by fibrous connective tissue. In the diagram, a fibrous joint has been depicted where the bones 1 and 2 are joined by fibrous connective tissue, depicted in green. So that is fibrous tissue. Fibrous tissue. In a cartilaginous joint, the second variety, bones 1 and 2 are joined by a piece of cartilage. And the third variety, that is a synovial joint, is one where the bone 1 and 2 who form the joint, they are separated by a cavity. So there is a cavity intervening between the joint. So joint containing cavity, and this cavity is enclosed in a fibrous capsule that hold the bones together. So there goes the three structural types of joint: fibrous, number 2 cartilaginous, and number 3 the synovial joint. Next we discuss the fibrous joints in detail. By this time we know the definition of fibrous joints. A fibrous joint is one where the bones forming the joint are united by fibrous connective tissue. These fibrous joints are either immobile or they permit only slight degree of movement. Okay. So fibrous joints are either immobile or partly mobile. And a fibrous joint does not have any joint cavity. And there are three types of fibrous joints. So fibrous joints are of three types. Number one, suture. Number two, syndesmosis. And number 3, gomphosis. Three types of fibrous joints: sutures, syndesmosis, and gomphosis. So let's discuss all of them one by one, starting from the sutures. Okay. So what is a suture? Now, in a suture, the articular surfaces are connected by a thin layer of connective tissue, which is called sutural ligament. Let me tell you one thing first, that the sutures are exclusively found in the skull. So sutures are exclusive in skull. Basically, the skull bones, which are plate like, they are joined together by sutures. Okay. For example, this is the frontal bone in the skull, and this is the parietal bone. The junction between the frontal and parietal is a suture. Now, depending upon the shape of the articular surfaces, I mean the surfaces that take part in formation of the joint, depending upon the shape of them, these joints are further divided into the following categories. So this is a suture, a kind of fibrous joint between the skull bones, and there are certain subcategories under the suture depending upon the shape of the articular surfaces or margins. So let's talk about the type of suture. Okay, so by definition, sutures are a type of fibrous joint which are confined to the skull, or they are peculiar to the skull, and they are immobile joints. Okay, though in growing children they may permit a little mobility. That means in growing children the skull bones can move about a little bit, okay, with respect to one another. Now, depending upon the shape of the articular surfaces or margins of the skull bones, these suture joints are further subdivided into the following categories. What are they? First, we get the plain suture. Plain. What is the meaning of plain suture? Let me elaborate. A plain suture is one where the articular surfaces, that means surfaces which are forming the joint, the articular surfaces are plain and smooth. So that is a plain suture. And there is the sutural ligament between the two plain and smooth articular surfaces. Next variety is a serrate suture. Serrate. The articular surfaces or margins of the sutures are reciprocally serrated. Serrated means like the tooth of a saw. Korater je dant tar moto. Reciprocally serrated. And they interlock with each other in a jigsaw manner. And in between them lie the sutural ligament. So that is a serrate suture. Number two. Number three is the denticulate suture, where the margins of the suture interlock with each other like teeth. Denticulate. So they resemble like teeth interlocking with one another, and there is intervening sutural ligament or sutural connective tissue. So that is the denticulate suture. Number four is the squamous suture. The articular margins or surfaces are relatively flat, but they overlap. What is the term? Overlap. So one margin is overlapping. What is the meaning of overlap? Overlap means one margin is partially hanging over the other bone. So in plain suture we get the margins are like this. That is the plane. But in overlapping suture the margins are like this, where one bone, suppose the bone number 1, the margin of bone number 1 is partially hanging over the bone 2. Okay, overlapping. So partially into the territory of other bone. Suppose this is bone A, and this is the B. Okay. So by overlapping we mean that part of margin of A is actually hanging over part of the bone B. A, B. So the articular margin of A is hanging partly over B. That is called overlap. Okay. And the fifth type is the syndilesis. Fourth is the overlapping or squamous suture. Squamous suture. And the fifth is the syndilesis. Syndilesis. What is syndilesis? It is a specialized suture where a ridge of one bone fits into the groove of another bone. So there is a ridge of one bone fit into the groove of other bone, and in between them is the sutural ligament or fibrous tissue. So that is the syndilesis. So based upon the nature of articular margins or surface, there are five types. One is the plain suture, one is the serrate suture, one is the denticulate suture, one is the overlapping suture, and the last but not the least is the syndilesis. Okay. After suture, the second variety is the syndesmosis. Now in syndesmosis, what happens? That two adjacent bones, they are mainly parallel bones, they are linked together by a considerably greater amount of connective tissue than compared to suture in the form of a membrane, which is called interosseous membrane. So in syndesmosis, two parallel bones are joined together by a considerably more amount of connective tissue in the form of a membrane or maybe in the form of a ligament, but the amount of connective tissue is much more, and that is known as syndesmosis. And last but not the least, the kompphosis. So that is the second kind, suture syndesmosis. And number three, fibrous joint, is the gomphosis, which is also called peg and socket joint. These are specialized fibrous joint which are restricted to the teeth. Actually, the teeth is fixed in the alveolar socket of the lower jaw or upper jaw. So this is the alveolar socket of lower jaw or mandible, and this is the teeth. This teeth is fitted in the socket by fibrous ligaments, which is called periodontal ligament. What is the name? Periodontal ligament. And this kind of joint in case of teeth is called gomphosis. Gomphosis. So in gomphosis we get to see the periodontal ligament, in syndesmosis we get to see the interosseous membrane. Okay, this one. And in suture we get to see the sutural ligament in between the articular margins. Next we will discuss the cartilaginous joints. A cartilaginous joint is one where the bones, suppose this is a bone A and this is another bone, that is B. These two bones are joined by a piece of cartilage. There are two types of cartilaginous joints, primary and secondary. Types 1, primary, 2, secondary. Two types of cartilaginous joints. We will discuss the definition of primary and secondary cartilaginous joints along with their differences. Okay. Now, in case of a primary cartilaginous joint, primary, the bones forming the joint are joined by a plate of hyaline cartilage. So if this is a bone A and this is a bone B, A and B are joined by a piece of hyaline cartilage. That is a primary cartilaginous joint. Example, the joint between the sternum and the ribs, that is the costosternal joint. In this diagram, the joint between the diaphysis is a tubular part of a growing long bone, and the ends of a growing long bone is called epiphysis. So the joint between the diaphysis or the shaft of a growing long bone and epiphysis or the end of a growing long bone is joined by a piece of hyaline cartilage. That's why this type of joint in a growing long bone is called primary cartilaginous joint. So primary cartilaginous joint is one where the bones are joined by hyaline cartilage, plain and simple. Okay. Next we move on to the secondary cartilaginous joint. What is secondary cartilaginous joint? A secondary cartilaginous joint is one where the articular surfaces of bones forming the joint are covered by a thin plates of hyaline cartilage. Suppose this is A and B. The articular surfaces of A and B, first they are covered by a thin plate of hyaline cartilage. Hyaline. And these two hyaline cartilages are further connected by a disc or pad of a fibrocartilage. So these hyaline cartilages are furthermore connected by a fibrocartilage. So that is the secondary cartilage. Secondary cartilaginous joint. Two hyaline cartilage which cover the articular ends are further joined by a fibrocartilage. Example is symphysis pubis, where the pubic bones which are covered by the hyaline cartilage are joined by a disc of fibrocartilage in between the hyaline cartilage. So in secondary cartilaginous joint, a fibrocartilaginous disc, a fibrocartilaginous disc connect the bones which are covered by hyaline cartilage. Connects bones covered by hyaline cartilage. So let's now distinguish between two of them. That is the primary cartilaginous joint and secondary cartilaginous joint. So here we write primary on this side, secondary. The primary cartilaginous joint are also known as synchondrosis. Synchondrosis. And the secondary cartilaginous joints are known as symphysis. Symphysis. In primary cartilaginous joints, the bones are joined by a plate of hyaline cartilage. Okay. Connected by hyaline. Whereas in secondary cartilaginous joint, bones are first covered by hyaline cartilage and connected by fibrocartilage. So hyaline cartilage covered bones connected by fibrocartilage. The primary cartilaginous joint disappears with age. That is, the hyaline cartilage that joins the bones together is converted into bone itself. So it tends to disappear with age. Disappear with age. But secondary cartilaginous joint, they tend to remain throughout the lifetime. Remain all through lifetime. And the primary cartilaginous joint rarely occur in the midline of the body. Rarely occur in midline. Peculiarly, the secondary cartilaginous joint always occur in the midline. For example, the symphysis pubis between the pubic bones, the intervertebral disc between the adjacent vertebrae, etc. So they remain in midline. So that is the difference between the primary and secondary cartilaginous joints. Now we discuss the synovial joints. We know already that synovial joints are those joints which possess a cavity. So these joints are joints with cavity. Suppose this is bone A and this is bone B. A and B are forming a synovial joint and they are separated by a cavity. This cavity is enclosed in a fibrous capsule that holds the A and B together. And this cavity is known as synovial cavity, which is filled with a fluid known as synovial fluid. So, in a nutshell, synovial joints are those which possess cavity and that cavity is enclosed in fibrous capsule and filled with fluid. These joints are freely mobile and they permit maximum mobility in between the connecting bones. Okay. Freely mobile. So we have done with the definition. Next we go along the characteristics and important components of synovial joints one by one. Okay. So first discuss the important features and then go on describing the important features. So what are the important features? First is the articular surfaces are covered by a thin plate of hyaline cartilage. So hyaline cartilage is covering the articular surfaces of the bones. So articular surface of bone A and bone B both are covered by blue colored hyaline cartilage in the diagram. Okay. Now with few exceptions, the articular cartilage is always made up of hyaline cartilage. With few exceptions, that means hyaline cartilage is the cartilage that mostly lines the bones. Except in those bones which are ossified in membrane, there instead of hyaline cartilage, there is fibrocartilage. In short, hyaline cartilage is the cartilage that lines the bone forming the synovial joint. Hyaline cartilage is avascular. That means there is no blood vessel in the hyaline cartilage. It is non-nervous, no nerve supply as well, and elastic in nature. Okay. The main chemical component of hyaline cartilage is proteoglycan hyaluronic acid aggregate. Main chemical component is proteoglycan hyaluronic acid component. Okay. The hyaluronic acid retains water and resists the compression. Now, what is the function of this hyaline cartilage? Why it is here? Actually, the hyaline cartilage that is covering the end articular ends of the bones, they provide smooth friction free movement. Whenever there is a movement in the synovial joint, there is a little bit of friction between the bones. Hyaline cartilage minimizes the friction. They provide a very slippery surface. Okay, so function is number one, minimizing friction. And what is the number two function? Number two is that they resist compressive forces. What is the meaning? Suppose you are jogging. Whenever you are jogging on the ground, due to continuous thrust on the ground, your bones of the knee joint, suppose, they are compressed, tend to be compressed against each other. Right? When you are continuously jumping or jogging on the hard ground, bones forming the knee joint tend to get compressed against each other. The hyaline cartilage cap over the component bones resist the compressive force. So whenever the bones are tending to get compressed against each other, this is the cartilage covering or hyaline cartilage covering that resists the compressive force. That means that resists the direct impact between the two bones. They resist or they prevent the direct collision between the two bones when they are compressed. So resist compression. Okay, so that is a hyaline cartilage. So articular cartilage, that means the cartilage that covers the articular end of the bones, is the hyaline cartilage. Articular end means the end that forms the joint. Next, we will discuss about the articular capsule. Okay. We know that the joint cavity is completely enveloped by a fibrous capsule. So this is the fibrous capsule. This capsule is basically a ligament and made up of collagen fibers that connect the bones forming the joint. So this is called fibrous capsule or capsular ligament. Capsular ligament, same thing. A ligament is a structure that connect the bones. So fibrous capsule, as it is connecting the two bones, it is also known as capsular ligament. Now the thing is that the capsular ligament is lined on its inner aspect by a synovial membrane. There is a very vascular membrane in red that is lining the inner surface of the capsule. And this membrane not only lines the capsule but also line part of the bone up to the part of the bone up to the hyaline cartilage. But synovial membrane does not cover the hyaline cartilage. So they cover only the portion of the bone which is inside the joint and which is outside the covering of the hyaline cartilage. So synovial membrane covers the portion of the bone inside the joint which is not covered by hyaline cartilage. So that is the synovial membrane. Together the fibrous capsule and synovial membrane, these two structures together, they are known as the articular capsule. Articular capsule. Okay, articular capsule. So articular capsule is the collective term which means the fibrous capsule plus the synovial membrane. What is the function of fibrous capsule? The fibrous capsule stabilizes the joint. It permits the movement, but it resists the dislocation. So it is holding the bones together, so it prevents the dislocation of the bones, but it permits movement because the bones are separated by some distance. So what is the function of the fibrous capsule? Fibrous capsule, number one, permit movement, resist dislocation. And what else? The fibrous capsule is supplied by numerous sensory nerve endings. Now if this is the fibrous capsule, numerous sensory nerve endings are ending up here and they convey the sensation from the fibrous capsule. So when the sensory nerves, these are the sensory nerves which supply the fibrous capsule, when the sensory nerves are stimulated, they produce contraction of muscles in such a way so that the joint is brought in a position of maximum comfort. That means when the sensory nerves supplying the capsule are stimulated, they bring the joint in an optimum position, in a most suitable position. That is called the watchdog action of the capsule. Watchdog action of capsule. Okay, so when the fibrous capsule, is stretched, it stimulates the sensory nerve endings, and this sensory nerve in turn, they produce contraction of muscles which act on the joint and bring the joint in a position of maximum comfort to protect the joint. So that is called the watchdog action of the capsule. Now in this respect we will discuss about the two types of ligament related to joint. Already I have told you that fibrous capsule itself a ligament, because a ligament by definition connects two bones and fibrous capsule connect the articulating bones. Now let me give you the example of knee joint. In the knee joint, the articulating bones are femur above, tibia below, and in front is the patella. That has not been shown. This other bone, which is the fibula, does not take part in formation of knee joint. Only the femur, tibia and patella take part in formation of knee joint. Now we are considering the case of femur and tibial articulation, which is called the femoro-tibial part of knee joint. Now in the femoro-tibial part of knee joint, let me show the fibrous capsule in black. Okay. Now, outside the fibrous capsule, the fibrous capsule is made up of collagen fibers. Outside the fibrous capsule, there are local thickening of fiber bundles. So, outside the capsule, there are local thickening of fiber bundles. These fibers are actually part of the capsule itself, but there is a localized thickening which can be easily figured out from outside. So, from outside, we can easily see the thickening of fibers over the capsule. These ligaments are called true ligaments. True ligaments means localized thickening of the fiber bundles of capsular ligament. That means some fibers of the capsular ligament is thickened to form these additional ligaments, which are called true ligaments. And there are other kind of ligaments which are known as accessory ligament, which are actually separate from the fibrous capsule. Here, in case of knee joint, there is a cross-shaped arrangement of ligaments which connect the femur and tibia, and they are obviously separated from the capsular ligament. This cross-shaped ligament is called cruciate ligament, and they are the example of accessory ligaments. So, accessory ligament is one which is separate from the fibrous capsule and they join the bones together. They may present within the capsule. In this case, the cruciate ligaments are present within the capsule, so they are intracapsular, or they may be present outside the capsule. So, true ligaments are part of the capsule itself, outside thickening of the capsule, and accessory ligaments are separate from the capsules. So, we have discussed about the hyaline cartilage, articular capsule, and the ligaments, true and the accessory ligament. Next, we will discuss about the synovial membrane. Okay. Synovial membrane. So, synovial membrane is a thin and highly vascular membrane of connective tissue that line the inside of the fibrous capsule. So, inside the fibrous capsule, there is a very thin layer of connective tissue membrane that is called synovial membrane. And it not only lines the fibrous capsule, but it also lines the bone inside the synovial cavity, and it lines the bone up to the margin of hyaline cartilage. So, synovial membrane does not cover the hyaline cartilage. So, synovial membrane is a highly vascular membrane which lines the articular capsule, or which lines the fibrous capsule, and also lines the bone up to the margin of hyaline cartilage. Synovial membrane. Okay. The function of synovial membrane is that it produces synovial fluid in sufficient quantity to keep the surfaces properly lubricated. So, here is the synovial fluid which lubricates the joint. The synovial fluid is very thick and viscous, Viscous means it is kind of jelly like, thick and viscous. And it is actually derived from the blood plasma. So it is called that synovial membrane which secrete the synovial fluid. It's actually making the fluid out of the plasma of the blood vessels that are present within it. We know that synovial membrane is very vascular, so there are numerous blood vessels in the synovial membrane. All these blood vessels are containing blood, and in the blood there is plasma. So from that plasma of the blood that are present in the vessels of the synovial membrane, the synovial fluid is secreted. The synovial fluid is formed from the blood plasma, and the chief component of the synovial fluid is hyaluronic acid. That is an important question, hyaluronic acid. It is this hyaluronic acid which is responsible for the thick and viscous property as well as the lubricating property of the synovial fluid. So it is the hyaluronic acid, very important. Okay, so that is about the synovial fluid, right? Next is the articular disc or meniscus. What about it? The articular disc are pad of fibrocartilage which are interposed between the articular surfaces of some joint. So in this joint, for example, there are two articular disc. These are actually pads of fibrocartilage. Fibrocartilage pads. They are present between the articular surfaces of the joints. And what they are doing? They are actually maintaining an interval. They are maintaining a gap between the articular surfaces. And it helps in proper lubrication of the joint. So what is their function? Number one, maintain an interval for proper lubrication. Number two, they divide the joint completely or incompletely into compartments. So next function is compartmentalization. They also act to modify certain joint movements. Number three, modify joint movements. And also prevent wear and tear of articular hyaline cartilage by providing a cushioning effect. So they act as a cushion between the hyaline cartilage, which are depicted in green. So in between the hyaline cartilage, they are actually acting as a cushion and providing a cushioning effect. So this cushioning effect prevents the wear and tear of the hyaline cartilage. Okay. So these are the main function of the articular disc or meniscus. Articular disc are also known as the articular meniscus. This sort of articular disc can be seen in the knee joint. The next important component are the bursa and fat pads. What is a bursa? A bursa is a pouch that is filled with synovial fluid. Take the example of knee joint. Above is the femur, below is the tibia. Now there is a bursa. Let me show you. There is a bursa in between this muscle and in between the femur. So in between the muscle and the bone there is a pouch which is filled with synovial fluid. Similarly, there is also another bursa over here which intervenes between these three muscles, sartorius, gracilis and semitendinosus muscle, and the bone. So why these bursas are there? The bursa, being a pouch filled with fluid, they reduce the friction of one structure moving over the other. So function of bursa is essentially to cushion certain muscles and facilitate the movement of muscles over bony surfaces. So bursa, in plural bursi, they facilitate movement of muscle or tendons. Okay. Then you get to see the fat pads. What is a fat pad? In certain joints, there are pads of fat which are placed between the synovial membrane and the fibrous capsule, or between the synovial membrane and the bone. For example, in the hip joint, we get to see a layer of fat depicted in yellow between the head of the femur, that is the femur bone, head of femur, and the acetabulum. So there is a fat pad. This fat pad is very flexible and they actually help the joint during different movements by act as a soft cushion. So fat pad, they are seen in certain joint, for example in hip joint, and they are present between the bone and the capsule or between the synovial membrane and bone, etc. So we have discussed about the fat pads. So fibrous capsule, ligaments, synovial membrane, articular cartilage, articular disc, bursa and fat pads have been briefly discussed. Next on to the clinical correlation, that is very important. Next we discuss about some clinical terms related to the synovial joint. First, the arthroplasty. Arthroplasty means surgical repair or replacement of the joints. Surgical repair or replacement of the joint, that is called the arthroplasty. Okay. Next we get two terms, osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis. So first of all, what is osteoarthritis? We know that the hyaline cartilage is covering the articular ends of the bones in a synovial joint. Now, osteoarthritis is a condition where the articular hyaline cartilages are degenerated. They are lost either due to a disease process or due to any trauma. And the synovial fluid is reduced. Okay. So osteoarthritis is basically a condition where the articular hyaline cartilage degenerates due to disease. So the hyaline cartilage is actually lost over time. And this condition mostly affects the large weight bearing joints like hip joint and knee joint. So that is the osteoarthritis. Degeneration, loss, deterioration of the articular hyaline cartilage. Now, what happens in rheumatoid arthritis? Rheumatoid arthritis is also an inflammation of the articular cartilage, but here the loss of the articular cartilage occurs due to completely different reason. In osteoarthritis, the articular hyaline cartilage loss occurs due to damage or due to disease like infection. But in rheumatoid arthritis, the articular cartilage is lost due to autoimmune reaction. That means body's own antibody is attacking its own articular cartilage. So as a result of autoimmune reaction, the articular cartilage is lost. And the joint cavity is filled up with excessive amount of fluid. So that is the main difference between the rheumatoid and osteoarthritis. So osteoarthritis is a degenerative change. And rheumatoid arthritis is an autoimmune disorder. Osteoarthritis occurs due to infection or due to damage, and rheumatoid arthritis occurs due to autoimmune reaction, where the body's defense mechanism combats against its own component. Okay, what is an osteophyte? Osteophyte is new bone. New bone formation. Okay, actually, in case of osteoarthritis, what happens is that suppose this is a bone forming the synovial joint, which is capped by the hyaline articular cartilage. Now, the margin of the hyaline articular cartilage, the periphery of the hyaline articular cartilage, here the bone which is at the periphery of the hyaline articular cartilage, it is endowed with immense proliferative power. This bone has immense growth potential, mane era khub shohojei bere uthte pare. So in case of osteoarthritis, when the articular cartilage is damaged, ekhane articular cartilage ki hocche, damage hoye jacche, khoy prapto hocche, articular cartilage is becoming lost, getting lost over time, তখন কি হচ্ছে, ইন অর্ডার টু মেক আপ ফর দিস লস দেয়ার ইজ গ্রোথ ফ্রম দ্য মার্জিন অফ দ্য আর্টিকুলার কার্টিলেজ অ্যান্ড দিস এক্সেস বোনস হুইচ আর ফর্মড অ্যাট দ্য মার্জিন আর নোন অ্যাজ অস্টিওফাইটস। ওকে, সো আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড হোয়াট ইজ দ্য অস্টিওফাইট। সো অস্টিওফাইটস আর পিসেস অফ বোন দ্যাট ফর্মস অ্যাট দ্য মার্জিন অফ দ্য আর্টিকুলার কার্টিলেজ ওয়েন দ্য আর্টিকুলার কার্টিলেজ স্টার্টস গেটিং লস্ট ইন কেস অফ অস্টিওআর্থ্রাইটিস। সো উই আর গেটিং এ ক্লিয়ার পিকচার অফ অল দ্য টার্মস that are associated with a synovial joint. Now we will discuss about the classification of synovial joints. First is according to the shape of articular surfaces. According to the shape. Of articular surfaces. So first category under this classification type is the plane joints. Plane joint. A plane joint is one where the articular surfaces are nearly flat or plane like this and they permit gliding movement in various directions. Side by side, front and back, different kind of gliding movement. And this is the simplest type of joint movement. Plane. Example, the intercarpal joint in the hand. Intercarpal joint in hand. Basically, carpal bones are the bones which are present at the side of the wrist region of the hand, and there are 8 carpal bones, and the intercarpal joints belong to the plane variety. Okay, so that is an intercarpal joint. You can see the articular surfaces, they are plane. So first is the plane. Next variety is the hinge variety. Number 2 is a hinge. In this variety, the movements are permitted only in one plane around a transverse axis, much like the hinge of the door. As the door only closes and opens around a certain hinge in a transverse axis. Similarly, these joints allow movements only around one axis. For example, in elbow, the humerus articulates with the ulna. In a hinge joint, so the humero-ulnar joint is a hinge joint. There is either flexion or extension of the elbow joint. We either bend the forearm bones forward, which is called flexion, or straighten them, that is called extension. Okay, so that is the number 2 type of joint, hinge. So plane and hinge, 2 variety. What is the number 3 variety? Number 3 is called the pivot or trochoid joint. Number 3 is the pivot. Pivot joint is characterized by presence of a rod inside a ring shaped structure. So we can see this sort of joint in between the first and second cervical vertebra. The first cervical vertebra is known as atlas. There is an osseoligamentous ring of atlas vertebra formed by part of the atlas vertebra and part of a ligament. In between the ring, there is presence of odontoid process of axis. Odontoid process is present in the ring of atlas, dens or odontoid process of axis vertebra. So the joint between the atlas and axis, or the atlantoaxial joint, is an example of the pivot joint. Okay, so number 3 is the pivot joint. Number 4, we get the condylar joint. Number 4. In condylar joint, there is a round articular surface of one bone fits into socket like articular surface of another bone. The end of bone bearing the round surface is called condyle. So there is a round articular surface of one bone that fits into another bone carrying a socket for the round part. This rounded articular surface is called condyle. Okay, and this sort of joints are called condylar joints. So condylar, and condylar joints permit movement in two direction, up and down and side by side. Movement occur in two direction in case of a condylar joint. Next variety is an ellipsoid joint. Number 5. Ellipsoid. There is an elliptical convex surface of one bone that articulate with elliptical concave surface of another bone. So here is the elliptical convex articular surface is fitted into an elliptical concave articular surface of another bone, and the movements are permitted in two directions, around the transverse axis and around the anterior posterior axis. Okay, so movements are bidirectional. Ellipsoid. Next variety is saddle or sailor joints. Saddle. In saddle joint, the articular surfaces are reciprocally saddle shaped or concave convex. You can see the articular surfaces are concave convex and they reciprocally fit with one another. For example, the sternoclavicular joint. Sternoclavicular joint, and The last but not the least variety is a ball and socket joint. Ball and socket. Ball socket. So there is a rounded convex articular surface of one bone which is called the ball that fits into a cup shaped socket of another bone, that is called ball and socket variety. Example, hip joint, shoulder joint. Example, shoulder joint, hip joint, etc. Right? So that is the classification according to the shape of articular surfaces: plane, hinge, pivot, condylar, ellipsoid, saddle, ball and socket. Then according to the plane of movement, it is pretty easy: uniaxial, biaxial and multiaxial. Uniaxial means the movements occur only in one plane. Example, in case of hinge joint, let me show you. Uniaxial hinge joint. What is biaxial? The movements are permitted occurring, the movements are occurring in two planes. Okay, for example, the condylar joints, the ellipsoid joints. So this is a biaxial joint. Similarly, the ellipsoid joint is a biaxial joint. So uniaxial is a hinge joint. Uniaxial is also the pivot joint. Hinge pivot. Okay. Biaxial is a condylar ellipsoid biaxial, and then the polyaxial or multiaxial joint. Movements occur in three planes. Example, ball and socket joint. So in ball and socket joint, movement in three planes. For example, there is flexion extension, adduction abduction, medial rotation, lateral rotation. Three types. So if we take the case of the shoulder joint, there is flexion extension, there is medial rotation, lateral rotation, there is abduction, adduction in the shoulder joint. All is occurring over in the shoulder joint. Okay. So shoulder joint or the ball and socket joint, it is also a multiaxial joint. Multiaxial. Another classification is done according to the number of articulating bones. If two bones are forming the joint, suppose A and B, that is a simple joint. Is more than two bones, suppose A, B and C are forming the joint, that is a compound joint. More than two bones. Example of compound joint, the elbow joint. Let me show you a diagram of elbow joint and you will understand. In elbow joint, the arm bone, that is the humerus, that articulates with the forearm bone, two of them, radius and ulna. So that elbow joint is formed by three bones, so it is a compound joint. And last but not the least, a complex joint. A complex joint is one where the joint cavity is divided into compartments by a meniscus. We know that a meniscus is a fibrocartilaginous partition in the joint cavity. So this meniscus is compartmentalizing the joint cavity, and this type of joint cavity, which is divided into compartments, is known as a complex joint. Complex joint. Example, knee joint. So that is the basic classification of the synovial joints.